Hello and welcome to New Frontiers on CCTV International. I'm Ji Xiaojun in Beijing. And today we reach the concluding part of our journey of exploration into one of China's oldest and most popular performing arts, Kunqu Opera. Following the founding of New China, the policy of cultural reawakening offered Kunqu Opera the chance to emerge from a long period of neglect. New Kunqu Opera troupes were set up across the country. Miraculously, despite only recently being reborn, Kunqu Opera was even able to survive the harsh political climate during the Cultural Revolution.
In November 1981, the ancient city of Suzhou greeted a group of overseas Chinese who had returned to China to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the founding of the Suzhou Kunqu Workshop. All of the 16 performing artists, by that time advanced in age, were from the Chuan generation. Repressed during the 10 years of the Cultural Revolution, Kunqu was struggling its way back to life. But an old question remained, just what should Kunqu be aiming at? At a Kunqu festival held by the provinces of Jiangsu and Zhejiang and the city of Shanghai, the State Ministry of Culture suggested preservation, continuation, innovation, and development. At the festival, two Kunqu troupes, one from Jiangsu and the other from Shanghai, staged the same drama, the Peony Pavilion. The two renditions of the classic work were very different, making them rival productions. The production of the Peony Pavilion, presented by the Jiangsu troupe, was highly traditional, made particularly impressive by Zhang Jiqing's simple but elegant performance. It won a warm response from audiences. The Shanghai version, on the other hand, was imaginative and innovative. As the story unfolded, the backdrops behind Hua Wenyi, playing the lead female role Lady Du, constantly changed, from her study to her boudoir, her garden, and a Taoist temple. And there were also many changes in the stage lighting. Even more unexpectedly, however, in the Shanghai version, a number of the melodies had been altered, with some of the more challenging lyrics, incomprehensible to some, cut completely. These changes naturally aroused considerable debate among experts, and the question of how to approach the preservation of Kunqu became a hot topic. In the end, both troops received awards. The Jiangsu troop received a Kunju Continuity Prize, while the Shanghai troop won the Innovation Award. But the arguments didn't stop, and they continue today. Each of the two troops had gone to considerable effort to attract audiences back to Kunju Theatre. But the question remained whether, after so many years in oblivion, Kunju would be able to arouse again the feelings it had in the past. As China's economy developed at a fast pace in the 1980s, the decade became one of changes. Pop music was gaining popularity, and so were other types of Western culture in the form of books and movies. People were showing great enthusiasm for following the new trends, and traditional opera forms were being cold-shouldered. To any performing artist at the time, whether established or new, one fact was beyond dispute. Kunju was losing audiences. Wang Fang, vice chairman of the Suzhou Kunju troupe, still remembers the dilemma Kunju faced at that time. Kunju was only allowed to be staged in a small number of small theatres, and so many performers had no choice but to look elsewhere for work. Wang Fang, an actress who specialised in young female roles, couldn't even find an actor to perform opposite her.
80年代中后期到90年代的中期的那一阶段，戏曲特别不景气。
那就这一辈的人呢，走了很多，就都转业了，就改行了，就戏曲没人看嘛。像我们同学60个，60个学员都改行了，留下的大概是十几个，啊，有出国的，有女孩子嫁到国外去的，有下海经商的，还有更多的拍影视的。
And it was not only these artists who were having to face this situation. Artists of the older generation were equally affected. When one of the country's seven major Kunju troops, the Yongjia Kunju troupe in Wenzhou, disbanded in 1984, a letter was mailed from Shanghai to Zhongnanhai, where the central government was in residence. The letter was from established Kunju artist Yu Jianfei, and it would change the overall situation for Kunju.
Yu老师政协委员又是昆剧界的最有代表性的人物了，我是请他给中央写信。
In his letter, Yu Jianfei detailed all the worries and difficulties Kunju was facing and appealed to the central government to do something to preserve the opera form. The letter stated that every person in the Kunju profession wanted to say that Kunju should not be left to drown in the prevailing commercial tide, that the difficulties overwhelming Kunju were just temporary, and that one day, its significance would be fully appreciated by society.
He 22号接着信，24号就回去了，成立的文化部昆曲指导委员会。在那个情况之下，才决定了全国6个昆曲院团属于这个国家支持的。
After Yu Jianfei's letter, a series of policies and measures were adopted. The Ministry of Culture sponsored Kunju festivals to salvage a number of dramas that were on the verge of extinction, while efforts were also made by local troops to attract audiences back to the theatre. But whether these efforts would be enough to change the fate of Kunju and its performing artists remained unclear.
China's opening up since the end of the 1970s has provided Kunju opera troupes with greater opportunities to perform outside China. The good reception Quinchu has received overseas has given the performers considerable encouragement.
In the 1980s and 90s, local troops were given opportunities to perform abroad as representatives of traditional Chinese culture. They also performed in Hong Kong and Taiwan, leaving local audiences in raptures. The sensation aroused by the performances in Taiwan remains fresh in the memory of Zhang Jiqian. The warm reception was unforgettable.
观众的对你非常那个痴迷，就是讲很多年轻的、年纪大的票友也有，这些大学生、各个大学的大学生，所以在台湾演戏了，自己心里真是很开心，啊，觉得这才是演员。台湾一些教授，他们很得意，他们告诉我，说最好的昆曲演出在大陆，最好的昆曲观众在台湾。
The warm reception accorded the Quinchu troops from the mainland was not only seen in Taiwan, but also in Macau and Hong Kong. It seemed that all Chinese in those centres recognised that Quinchu was the root and blood of Chinese civilization, something that conveyed the values of Chinese and their state of mind. Meanwhile, with its great artistic significance and the superb skills required to perform it, Quinchu was impressing Western audiences as well.
Quinchu 真的是他非常能够欣赏。根据我的经验，我们有对完全是外国人的观众或者一半是外国人的观众演出演讲，他们都很能够感受到这种美。
Following in the footsteps of overseas Chinese, Quinchu has put down roots in foreign lands. Quinchu groups can now be found, among other places, in Japan and the United States. Zhang Huixin's group, established in 1995, is an influential one with a sizable audience. Every time Zhang's group performs, there is no shortage of spectators, as the locals regard watching a performance of Quinchu as a fine opportunity to understand China and Chinese culture. Clearly, genuine art has the power to overcome language and cultural barriers and be recognized. The charm of Quinchu is about the attraction of Chinese history and culture, and through it, the rest of the world can see a nation's pursuit of beauty.
Quinchu吗？没听说过。Quinchu毕竟是地方戏嘛，不是那个吧？从哪儿听说的呀？
电视上嘛，但是我不是很了解。喜欢吗？嗯，一般没有太多的感觉，就是老年人比较喜欢吧，或者是四五十岁的那样。
因为我现在不，我们追求的不是这个，都比如说流行歌曲。哦。
昆明的昆。
对对对对。
江苏的是吧？
我觉得是江苏的，具体哪个？哪个？不是很清楚。我们都不太清楚，对戏剧这一块没怎么研究。好，谢谢。
In
this, the first decade of the 21st century, Quinchu is already 600 years old. And it seems that to people scurrying about in the streets, Quinchu is simply too ancient or perhaps too refined. But how many people have any real knowledge of it? Whatever the answer, Quinchu has been out of the view of the general public for far too long.
现在人呢，艺术就是要迎合大众口味，所以只要迎合大众口味，我什么样都可以做。其实忘掉了艺术的最根本的责任。 就是要去不断地提升人们的欣赏的水平和欣赏的趣味。
那为什么现在是这么样一个状态呢？我觉得是不是说政府重视不够，是总体我们的这个文化水平没有达到那个程度。你的文化水平达到了那个程度，自然你就要重视到这个问题了。
The questions are how to choose between modernity and tradition, and how to go about preserving this treasure from the ancestors of today's Chinese in a time of so many changes and varying values. These are questions Chinese people are facing after walking out of an old era and into a new one.
苏州一直没有放弃对于传统文化的抢救，因为它是昆曲的故乡。2000年，我们办了第一届的中国昆曲艺术节，我们在想着怎么申报遗产，因为园林申报以后马上就热了，但是还没做成的时候，有了非物质遗产这一说，结果就在国家申报的很多的项目中间，我们的昆曲被选上了。
在2001年的5月18号，就是在这个巴黎的联合国捷克文组织总部，他有这个联合国捷克文组织的总干事长叫松浦晃一郎，由他来这个正式宣布，就是入选第一批代表作名单的19个项目，其中有中国的昆曲。而且这个中国的昆曲艺术啊，在这个19个项目里边呢，是评委全票通过的。
At the beginning of this century, Kuenchu, this ancient and highly refined art form, has regained its vitality.
这是我们中华民族的骄傲，这个一支强心针的力量，一下子就使得我们的昆曲受到了政府的重视，受到了国际的关注。
When a complete rendition of the Palace of Eternal Life was staged by the Suzhou Kuenchu troupe in Beijing in the autumn of 2004, Wang Fang, who 20 years before could not find a part to play, took the leading role of royal concubine Yang.
To Beijing 演出，那个北京的观众真的不得了，票全部卖完，而且就是等退票。那你这个感觉肯定不一样，是吧？就觉得自己很有价值感，很有成就感，就下面有那么多人。
When a young people's edition of The Peony Pavilion was presented by the Suzhou Kuenchu troupe, it too was a huge success.
And so, the ancient and mysterious art of Kunqu opera was back before the public. The elegant performing style and elaborate details became popular subjects of conversation.
First, they came in, they thought this was a good thing, they could be able to be closer to our traditional culture, then they could be able to know themselves from this point.
如果时尚也能够把人们的兴趣注意力引到我们的传统艺术里边去，那何乐而不为呢？
年轻人喜欢看，我认为这是个很重要的标志。如果说现代的年轻人不要看昆曲，昆曲很快就要亡的。
In this, universities play a vital role.As part of the effort to save Kuenchu, as suggested by the Ministry of Culture, Kuenchu is now included in the curriculum for universities, and plans have been made for 7 Kuenchu troupes to stage at least 20 non-profit shows on campus every year. Peony Pavilion and the Palace of Eternal Life have received a warm response from students.
我还没有看到过像这么热烈的场面。我觉得我们现在的大学生跟我们传统的文化、传统的艺术的经典还是血脉相通的。
China has entered a new century, one in which it is certain to rise. And Kunqu has come back to the stage with youth and vigor. It is returning to the life of the Chinese people. China's most recent Kunqu Festival, a festival held once every 3 years, was held in Suzhou in 2006, and it was the first festival since the central government's decision to preserve Kunqu. This time around, 7 troupes presented new Kunqu dramas, and troupes from Hong Kong and Taiwan made their festival debut. Today, Kunqu is often heard in the ancient city of Suzhou, with fans old and new gathering to compare notes.
Because Kunqu's life 跟中国文化的生命一样，不是只属于我们这一代，它是世世代代，我们要有这种宏观的这种视野，世界性的这种宏观的文化视野，我们的中国文化才会有发展。
我非常希望中国有更多的文化人能够尽早的来做这样的事情，就是在自己在做过很多奋斗的过程当中来寻找这个民族在存在过程当中的和你个人有联系的那种亮点，找到这个亮点，如果有暗淡的可能的话，我们有没有可能用我们的体温去守护它？
600 years ago, Gu Jian from Kunshan initiated Kunqu by innovating on the tunes of Nanqu, thus beginning what was to become a truly legendary form. 400 years ago, with his immortal The Peony Pavilion, Tang Xianzu ushered Kunqu into its most flourishing period. 300 years ago, the Palace of Eternal Life and Peach Blossom Fan entranced people across the country. Then, during the reigns of Empress Kangxi and Qianlong, Kunqu's position as the leading state opera was set. Two hundred years ago, Kunqu was perfected, and other opera forms that were just beginning to bud drew upon it for strength. The golden age of modern Chinese opera had begun. Around 80 years ago, some 40 young people were selected for training at the Suzhou Kunqu Workshop, and later, in what was the most difficult period Kunqu ever experienced, they loyally guarded its seeds. 50 years ago, Zhou Chuanying and other members of the Chuan generation staged 15 strings of cash. It would later be referred to as a single play that salvaged an opera form. Today, Kunqu has been revitalized, and it is ready for the next 100 years. On stages large and small, classical dramas are once again being presented through this opera form that is 600 years old. And today, Kunqu is recognized as part not just of the heritage of China, but of the whole human race.
There is a saying in China, the more traditional, the more international. Kunqu opera is one of the most valuable parts of China's cultural heritage. With its 600 years of history and its unique artistic beauty, it serves as a link between past and present, China and the world. And I hope you've enjoyed our series about Kunqu opera. And thank you for staying with us on today's New Frontiers. I'm Ji Xiaojun from CCTV International. See you next time.